foundation substance for his seed of Messiah. So moved on then to the next generation. And have a look here at Jacob's family. As I said, Jacob had two wives, two concubines, and 12 sons and one daughter. And so let's have a look. So one of the interesting things is that we often don't look at is the women in the Bible. But it's very interesting, here's a look and see. And this is about Leah. It says, Leah conceived and bore a son. And she named him Reuben, for she said, because the Lord has looked on my affliction, surely now my husband will love me. So the name Reuben means, you know, because God has looked on my affliction, God has looked on my suffering. Yes? I'm married to a man who hates me. My younger sister hates me. Yes? My miserable situation that he is in. So now she says, now I've given Jacob a son, surely he'll love me. She conceived again and bore a son and said, because the Lord has heard that I'm hated, he has given me this son. And she named him Simeon. You can see the pain in this lay of this woman's heart. Again she conceived and bore a son and said, now this time my husband will be joined to me, because I have borne him three sons, therefore he was named Levi. And the husband, Rachel. So sometimes people say, well, you know, the Bible's all written by men. But I think this is written by women. You have to understand this kind of aspect. Now when Rachel saw that she bore Jacob no children, she envied her sister, and she said to Jacob, give me children, or I shall die. Okay, here's the understanding that if you don't have children, you die. Yeah, because you know, lots of different things behind that. Jacob became very angry with Rachel and said, am I in the place of God, who's withheld from you the fruit of the womb? Then she said, here is my maid Bilhah. Go into her, that she may bear upon my knees, and that I too may have children through her. So Bilhah then has a son. Then Rachel said, God has judged me, and has also heard my voice, and given me a son. Therefore she named him Dan. Rachel's maid Bilhah conceived again, and she bore Jacob a second son. Then Rachel said, with mighty wrestlings I've wrestled with my sister, and have prevailed. And so she named him Naphtali. What do you think it was like, the relationships in his family? You can imagine. Incredibly complicated. Incredibly complicated emotional relationships. How did Jacob manage these four women? And how did they manage each other? Really complicated, difficult stuff going on here. Unimaginably difficult. But they were managed to do it. When Leah saw she'd ceased bearing children, she took her maid Zilpah and gave her to Jacob as a wife. Then Leah's maid Zilpah bore Jacob a son. And Leah said, good fortune. So she named him Gad. Leah's maid Zilpah bore Jacob a second son. And Leah said, happy am I. The women will call me happy. And she named him Asher. In the days of the wheat harvest, Reuben went and found mandrakes. So mandrakes were a sort of, like a sort of drug that would relieve people from depression. Mandrakes in the field and brought them to his mother Leah. And Rachel said to Leah, please give me some of your son's mandrakes. You can imagine that both of them really needed a good dose of one of these painkillers, antidepressants people take these days. I can't remember what they're called. Anyway, they were taking antidepressants. But she said to her, is it a small matter that you've taken away my husband? The language here is so painful, isn't it? Would you take away my son's mandrakes also? Rachel said, then he may lie with you tonight for your son's mandrakes. Then Leah said, and Leah fell pregnant, and Leah said, God has endowed me with a good dowry. Now my husband will honor me because I've borne him six sons. So she named him Zebulun. Intense, isn't it? Intense feelings that are going on here and expressed in these relationships between these sisters. Then God remembered Rachel, and God heeded her and opened her womb. She conceived and bore a son and said, God has taken away my reproach. which she named him Joseph. Okay. So one of the things you get in the Bible is that it's polygamy, but it's a mistake. Yeah. This never works out well. It's always incredibly intense relationships. Polygamy is always regarded as a mistake, and it's never and causing problems and not approved of anywhere in the biblical tradition. And general understanding is that Jacob should only have had one wife, and the reason he had two is because of what he did with his brother. Okay, what happened next? And so again, very interesting. So Joseph then was the son of Rachel. He was a favorite, Jacob's favorite son, and he got the robe of many colors. He had these dreams, you know, I dreamt this and the other. And you can imagine when he told us over breakfast, his brother probably got slapped, the little boy. You know, no way we're going to bow down in front of you. And it says here, when his brother saw the father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peacefully to him. So every time he wanted to have a conversation with Jacob, all these emotions and feelings came up and they just lost it, you know, their temper. And couldn't have a peaceful conversation with him. Anyway, so one day they saw him from afar. Before he came near, they conspired to kill him. So that's how intense it was. They hated their little upstart brother so much they wanted to kill him. Because sometimes, you know, Joseph would stay at home, and Jacob would say to Joseph, go and see how your older brothers are doing. So Joseph would go off and see his older brothers, and he'd come back and bring bad reports. Oh, my older brothers, they went to a party and they went to the pub and a wolf came and stole one of the sheep, but they're doing this. And so when Jacob came home, he would tell off all of his older sons. And the older son knew that Joseph was a snitch, or whatever you want to say. And they hated Joseph because he went around telling Dad about all the things they were doing wrong. So he was a terrible younger brother, and they decided they wanted to kill him. Quite understandable. In the end, they just sold him into slavery. Judah said, what profit is it if we can kill our brother, conceal his blood, so let's sell him into slavery. So they took him out of the pit and said to Ishmaelites, and they took Joseph to Egypt. You can imagine when Joseph has been taken out of the pit, he's probably, you know, saying to his brothers, you wait till I get home and tell Dad what you've done. You left me in this pit all day without any water. He's going to be really going to go for you and tell you off. And suddenly Joseph found himself sold into slavery. And you can imagine he probably thought, did I say something wrong? Did I upset my brothers? Why would they do this to me? This isn't fair. You know what I mean? And I can imagine that he started to think about all his childhood. Maybe I wasn't such a good younger brother. Maybe I spoke out of turn. Maybe, you know what I'm saying? And he started. So Joseph then had to go through this experience because he wasn't a good younger brother, so he could really mature and come to his senses. Just as Jacob shouldn't have had to go to Haran, but because he didn't behave the way he did, it was necessary for him to go there so he could go through all the processes he needed to go through to become a good younger brother. Yeah? Shouldn't have happened, but it did because that was what was necessary. Anyway, he goes on slavery and he gets bought and becomes Potiphar's. He gets bought by Potiphar, becomes in charge of Potiphar's household, becomes elevated to be doing very well. Then Potiphar's wife tries to seduce him, he doesn't give in to the seduction, but anyway, he gets thrown into prison. And so he's from the favourite son to getting sold into slavery, getting working his way up to be in charge of Potiphar's household, then thrown into prison. Yes? So he's gone through his incredible ups and downs, but during this time he became an unchanging person in terms of his faith and his relationship with God, as it shows here. Anyway, he gets taken out of prison, and I'm just going to go through this quickly, ends up interpreting Pharaoh's dream, so it's going to be 7 years of plenty, 7 years of famine, gets appointed prime minister, and then he gets in charge of the economic planning and to collect all the grain for 7 years, so when the 7 years of famine come, they got food. Anyway, the famine goes as far as Egypt, as far as Canaan. Jacob runs out of food, so he sends his 10 brothers, keeping Benjamin, Joseph's brother at home, sends the 10 older brothers, the sons of Leah, and concubines down to Egypt to buy grain. when they arrive there, Joseph recognizes them, and you know, you can imagine that. He hadn't seen them for years. He'd been so busy organizing all the economy and the finances and everything, and suddenly his older brothers appear. How do you think Joseph felt when his older brothers appeared?
Emotionally.
Yeah, you can imagine all kinds of, you can imagine all the memories from his childhood suddenly came back to the surface. All kinds of emotions, all kinds of feelings, all kinds of memories. Yes? And he had to decide, what am I going to do? Yeah? What could he have done?
He had two choices.
Yeah, he had a variety of choices. And so, you know, you can imagine really excited, my brothers are here. I haven't had any news from home. I wonder if mum and dad are still alive, etc., etc. You can imagine all that desire. But at the same time, these are my brothers who sold me into slavery. There's all kinds of stuff going on. Anyway, so he had them called, he interviewed them about who they were, where they came from, about their parents, etc., etc., etc. He got a lot of information out that he was interested in. And then he said, oh, I don't believe you, you're all spies. And he had them all thrown into prison for 3 days. And you can imagine that. He didn't know what to do. He couldn't reveal himself. He felt, anyway, he put them into prison, and gave him 3 days to think about what to do. And then he came up with, you know, some kind of, you know, found some peace within himself, put him in prison. Then he says, okay, next time you come, you have to bring with me your younger brother, Benjamin. And to make sure you are telling the truth and come back, I'm going to keep Simeon behind. Okay, so he kept Simeon, one of his brothers, behind in prison. So next time food runs out and Benjamin, the brothers say, we can't go back to Egypt to get more food without taking Benjamin with us. Jacob refuses. Then Judah says, okay, I'll make myself a surety, I'll make myself ransom for Benjamin. If something goes wrong, I will take the blame. You can blame me the rest of my life. So they arrive in Egypt, Joseph recognizes them. They all get invited around to the palace for dinner, and they have a nice dinner, and then Joseph toasts them with his silver cup and says, this is the cup that the Pharaoh gave me, and I'm going to toast you all with it in good health. And then they all go to bed, and then Joseph arranges for his cup to be put in Benjamin's sack. And then the next morning they all set off, and then Joseph says, someone stole my favorite cup, and sends the police after them. They go and they arrest the brothers, they go through all their sacks of grain, and they find the cup in Benjamin's sack. And then they're all brought back in front of Joseph. And this becomes very dramatic. And Judah says, what shall we say to my brother? What shall we speak? How can we clear ourselves? God has found out the guilt of your servants. Behold, we are my Lord's servants, both we and he also in whose hand the cup has been found. In other words, we're all guilty, you can put us all into prison, you can make us all your servants or your slaves, we're all guilty. Okay? But Joseph said, far be it from me that I should do so. Only the man in whose hand the cup was found shall be my servant. But as for you, go up in peace to your father. So Joseph is telling all the brothers, the only one who needs to stay behind in prison is Benjamin, because he's the one who stole my cup. The rest of you can go home. What could the brothers do at this point?
Okay,
yeah.
Well, thanks. Benjamin wasn't great.
Yeah, I'm going to say, Benjamin, bye. Yeah. Been a naughty boy. Enjoy the rest of your life. We're going home. We'll tell Dad. Okay, what a naughty boy. Could have done that, wouldn't they? And if they'd done that, what do you think Joseph would have done?
They realised the truth in the sin like himself.
They realised my selfish, nasty older brothers haven't changed. They're just as bad as they always were. And he would have got the guards to go and give them a good beating. Yeah, they probably would have given them a good beating because they would have deserved it. Okay. So what happens next? So they're having to make sure, throughout the Bible, people find themselves in situations they have to make choices. Okay, they could have done that, but they didn't. And this is what's very remarkable. Judah then speaks up, "Now therefore, as soon as I come to my father, and Benjamin is not with us, then as his life is bound up in the boy's life, as soon as he sees that the boy is not with us, he will die. For I became a pledge of safety for Benjamin to my father, saying, if I do not bring him back to you, then I shall bear the blame before my father all my life. Now therefore, please let me remain instead of the boy as a servant to my lord, and let the boy go back with his brothers. For how can I go back to my father if the boy is not with me? I fear to see the evil that would find my father." So what's Judah done here? So after Cain killed Abel, God came to Cain and asked Cain the question, what was it?
Where's your brother?
Where's your brother? And what was Cain's response?
Am I my brother's keeper?
Am I my brother's keeper? Who is in the position of Cain here? Who's your older brother?
Judah.
So what's his answer to that question?
I am my brother's
keeper. I am my brother's keeper here. So Judah, as the older brother, is willing to exchange his life for the life of his younger brother, Benjamin. Yes? So who was it who originally sold Joseph into slavery? You remember? I went through it pretty quickly. Judah was actually the brother who came up with the idea of selling Joseph into slavery. Okay? That's there. Judah's made a huge progress from selling his brother into slavery. He's gone to the point of willing to exchange his life for the sake of his younger brother, yes? You can imagine that. He's made a huge moral, spiritual progress in his life, thinking about all these things, and feeling, if ever the similar situation comes up again, I won't make the same mistake. And he finds himself in that situation, and he can either do what he did last time, or he can do it differently. So Judah then has overcome his fallen nature, and willing to exchange his life for the sake of his younger brother, Benjamin. Make sense? Good older brother. Okay? Then what happens next is also remarkable. And Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him, for they were dismayed at his presence. So Joseph said to his brothers, "Come near to me, please." And they came near. And he said, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now, do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here, for God sent me before you to preserve life. So it's not you who sent me here, but God. He's made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt." So what has Joseph done here?
He's forgiven his brothers.
He's done more than forgive his brothers.
Gave the glory to God.
Yeah. He's saying actually what happened was what was supposed to happen. You don't need to blame yourself or beat yourself up about it. Actually, it was part of God's plan that I should be sold into slavery so we could all we could all eat and we could all survive in the whole nation. Yes? So do you think it was God's will that Joseph should be sold into slavery? Was it God's original will?
No.
No. But it happened. Okay? And then Joseph looked back and he reinterpreted his life and embraced that situation as if it was God's will. And then he very magnanimously said to his brothers, "Don't beat yourself up about it. It was God's will. God sent me here." Who else did that? Jesus did this. Was the crucifixion the will of God? No, but Jesus, the fact that it happened. So afterwards, what did Jesus say to his disciples? If you read the Road to Emmaus, you read the things that Jesus said to his disciples following the resurrection, Jesus went through and he reinterpreted all the passages in Isaiah and said, actually, what happened was God's will. That through the crucifixion and the resurrection, you can bring rebirth and forgiveness and salvation of all humanity. So Jesus took what had happened as if it was God's will. So the reason why Christians believe that Jesus is supposed to die is because Jesus told them that was what's supposed to happen. You know what I'm saying? Jesus did what Joseph did. So Joseph established that pattern. And Father did the same thing. I remember when Father went to Danbury, of course, you know, whenever it was, 83 or something.
84.
84. You know, we were all kinds of court cases, prayer vigils, the whole works. But then when the day before Father went to Danbury prison, I remember him giving a speech and saying, it's God's will that I should go to prison in Danbury. And because of this, then it's going to become, you know, all sorts of stuff's going to go on with Christianity. The church is going to come to accept us and this, 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 and this. Okay, so Jesus, so Father also embraced it as God's will. He said, this is God's will. Because of this, all these good things will come about as a result. So it's Joseph who established his pattern, yes? Which then followed by Jesus, and followed by Father, and also other great people in history, like Nelson Mandela, Gandhi, and other people, took this same principle, and they used it to bring about huge change without blaming people. They're just, you know what I'm saying? They reinterpreted the story of their life. And sometimes people, something bad happens to somebody, and they always feel a sense of victimhood, yeah? But Joseph didn't do that. He went back and he looked and he reinterpreted the story of his own life and actually found meaning in it, all the bad things that had happened to him, and felt actually because of all these dreadful things that happened to me in my life, I have become the person I am today and I can do all the things that I'm doing. Yes? So in that sense he was liberated from the past became something meaningful and he wasn't looking for revenge or vengeance or anything else. He moved way beyond that. Yes? And so what was Joseph doing here with his brothers? He was setting his brothers up. He was giving his brothers a second chance. He was arranging it. He realized, you know, where do you think Joseph got this idea from? Be reconciled with his older brothers. Where did he get the idea?
Probably his father.
His dad. You can imagine Jacob had told stories about Uncle Esau, yes? And how he went to what he dealt with Uncle Laban, and how Uncle Laban treated him like this and this and this, and this is how he coped with it. This is how he processed and digested all the injustice and everything else. And eventually, he was able to do this and make it up with Uncle Esau. Yes, you can imagine these are the stories, the family stories that Jacob told, and his children. So all his sons knew these stories. So Joseph knew this story of what his dad had died because he'd upset his older brother. And he thought, okay, I've really upset my older brothers. You know, I need to do what Dad did. He said, this is more complicated because he only had one brother and I've got, you know, 10. But he did the same thing and he came up with a plan. How can I restore the relationship with my older brothers? Okay, I need, you know, if Joseph just revealed himself, his older brothers would have been shocked. You know, but what Joseph did, he set them up in a role play to put them in a similar situation than they were in before. So they could have the opportunity to do it differently, yes? In which case they could stand in front of him with dignity, knowing that they were no longer the same nasty, selfish brothers who sold him to slavery all those years before, but now they have changed and they could, yeah? So Joseph then is incredibly wise, incredibly magnanimous, incredibly generous by creating a situation where his brothers then could go through this situation and restore the mistake that they'd made so they could be reconciled properly. That makes sense? It's a beautiful, again, lesson of reconciliation, how to do these things. Yeah, these are just little excerpts, yeah? This is such a rich story, so many other aspects to it, which is so interesting and rich about human relationships and what one needs to do sometimes. Anybody here like to have a second chance? Yeah, third chance, yeah, fourth, yeah, 100. Yes, and Father also often gave us a second chance, yeah, to restore the mistake that we made. And that's wisdom over the other. Okay, and of course, how to go about that. Anyway, so reconciled, and, you know, he fell on his brothers, you can imagine that. He was telling my father, etc., etc., and then he fell on his brother Benjamin's neck and wept. Benjamin wept upon his neck and kissed all the brothers of reconciled. Again, it's a lot more to it than this. There were, in terms of foundation substance, this is where the real foundation substance was established. The Benjamin came from Rachel, the younger sister. Judah came from Leah, the older sister. There were all this stuff going on between Rachel and Leah. Yes, and here you've got the two sons. You know, you can imagine Judah and Benjamin. They would have heard all this, they would have known about the relationship between their mothers, yes? And all the stuff that was going on, jealousy, this, this, and this. You can imagine they resolved the relationship between their mothers in their generation. Yeah. So Benjamin then is Abel, Judah is Cain. So later on, King Saul came from the line of Benjamin, and David came from the line of Judah. And so you can imagine then, you know, Judah's willing to exchange his life with his younger brother. You can imagine how Benjamin must really loved his older brother. You can imagine they were completely inseparable. Yeah? And so when they ended up moving to Canaan, you look at the map, Judah and Benjamin, they lived next to each other. These two brothers, these two tribes, these two families were inseparable. And eventually they intermarried so much, you only had the tribe of Judah. Because they intermarried so much, they were inseparable. And so when the kingdom split, it was the tribes of Judah and Benjamin, that were the tribes in the southern kingdom. And Jesus himself came from the line of Judah. So that was a real substantial, lasting foundation subject. As I explained before, it should have been called 12 sons, but there were certain fractured relationships which weren't resolved, because too much water flowed under the bridge, as it had with Jacob and Esau. Certain depth of, again, there's lots of stuff you can read in the Bible, the relationship between Joseph and his other older brothers didn't become as deep as it could have been. Too much time had passed by to be able to do that. Anyway. So that's then why Jesus then came from Judah's lineage. The Judah was the older brother who'd overcome his fallen nature and made the foundation of substance receive the Messiah. Anyway, Judah had a wife. And his wife had three sons, Bela, Onan, and Shelah. And then, you know the story, married Tamar, but it says in the Bible that Bela was an evil man, and so God killed him. Yeah. That's what it says. So he was obviously not a good person. And then, as was the tradition in those days, then it's important for a person to have a lineage. And so normally what would happen then is that the next brother would marry his brother's wife, so that, well, not necessarily marry, but have a relationship with his brother's wife, so his older brother could have a lineage. But Onan didn't want to do this, because he thought, well, if my older brother has a lineage, then when dad dies, then the inheritance is going to be divided three ways, between Ur's descendant, me, and Shelah. If Ur doesn't have any kids, then the inheritance is only divided two ways. So he didn't go into Tamar, and so Tamar didn't become pregnant, and God wasn't happy with that, and so he died. So what do you think about Judah's kids? Are they worthy of being in the lineage of the Messiah? Okay, so Judah then, he married a Canaanite. The person he married wasn't someone of their tradition, their family. And so she didn't bring up her children well. So what happened then is that Tamar was sent away because Judah didn't want her to have a relationship with Shelah. And then eventually Judah's wife died. And then Tamar then wanted to continue this lineage because that was her duty. You know, that was a moral obligation in those days. That was just the way it was, the custom. And so she couldn't have a child with her, she couldn't have one with Onan, so she wanted to continue the lineage. She couldn't have with Shelah, and so she decided that she was going to have a relationship, have a child with Judah. This is after Judah's wife died. That was her desire. And that was a moral thing to do. She was in the right. That was her moral ethical responsibility at that time. So what should have happened then? The rabbis would say that Judah should have married Tamar. That Tamar was a good person, a good lineage, and that she was capable of bearing good children, unlike the wife that Judah did have, his first wife as a Canaanite. Anyway, so Tamar then, she became pregnant with Judah, as we know the story. And then Judah said, when Judah heard that she became pregnant, Judah said, bring her out and let her be burned. And she had been brought out. She sent word to her father-in-law by the man to whom these belong, and pregnant. And she said, please identify though whose these are, the signet, call, the star. And Judah identified her and said, she is more righteous than I, since I did not give her my son Shelah. Okay? So again, everyone has choices.